لله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته My dear brothers and sisters When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam first received that revelation in the Ghar al-Hira in the cave of Hira the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam immediately went to his wife Khadija radiyallahu ta'ala anha and he explained to her the situation what had happened And her response and how she reacted to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this very difficult time, seeing her husband extremely afraid, very scared of what had happened to him, seeing him behave in a manner that she had never seen before, her response was an amazing response and no doubt is a great success from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gave to her. Her response enabled the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to take on and absorb what had happened to him. And immediately what she did, radiallahu anha, was to take him to her cousin who was called Waraqatu ibn Nawfal radiyallahu anhu. Now, the first person to believe in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the first person to believe in al-Islam was the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Khadija. The second person to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is somebody maybe you have never heard of or maybe you've heard of but you didn't know. And that was the cousin of Khadija radiallahu anhu, whose name was Waraqatu ibn Nawfal, who at that time was known as a religious person who studied the previous scripture, the previous revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and was actually expecting that a prophet was going to arise from the people. And as we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he informed Waraqa about the revelation that he had received, immediately Waraqa said that this is the same one who came to you is the same one who came to Musa alayhi salam previously. And as we know also, that after this incident, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned home, that Waraqa radiallahu anhu, he passed away. I want to make mention here is that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first received the revelation that there was not the obligation to propagate Islam to all of the people of Mecca, it was only normal that the Prophet alayhi salam informed his wife and those closest to him. So we know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was the closest friend of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepted al-Islam. And we know that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, who was living with the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, accepted Islam straight away. He was only about 10 years old at the time. And as we know, Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu, who was the servant of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at this particular time, accepted Islam. These were the first people to embrace Islam. Khadija radiallahu anha, Waraqa, Abu Bakr, Ali ibn Abi Talib and Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhum. These were the first people to embrace Islam. And it was only natural for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to teach and call those people who were closest to him. The people of Mecca did not yet know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had received revelation. And for a period of time, for approximately 3 years, which maybe for some of us we think that's a long time. But for the first 3 years, this period is known as called as the Da'wah As-Sirriyah. It was the quiet call, the hidden call. And there was a great wisdom in this that many of the ulama that have mentioned. But before we mention some of those benefits, I want to mention what the effect that one da'i, one caller to Islam can have. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, after seeking permission from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said that there were certain people who may be inclined to the message of Islam if they were told it. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu permission to speak to certain individuals. Those individuals were who? They were Uthman ibn Affan, Zubayr ibn al-Awam, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, and Talhat ibn Ubaidillah. These five great companions, they accepted Islam walillah alhamd straight away. And you may know that these are five of the 10 who were promised the paradise. And they all accepted Islam at the hand of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now this doesn't mean that when a person has Islam, that they need to go and propagate it on a world stage. You need to take things slowly and you need to progress at your level and know whom that you are teaching Islam to. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu taught those who were closest to himself and his family. And this is exactly in line with what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he did with his own family. And this is in line with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in the Quran. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. O you who have believed, save yourselves and your families from the hellfire. So a person wants to save themselves from the hellfire, you start with yourself. You focus on yourself and your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, you begin with those who are closest to you, with your wife, with your children, with your mother and your father and your brothers and your sisters. Those who are closest to you in the bonds of kinship, these are the people that you are focusing on. And a common mistake is that maybe a family member will then go beyond, want to speak to the world and people in different countries and forget themselves and forget those people who are closest to them. We should remember the practice of the Prophet ﷺ and how he taught the companions in how to progress slowly in giving da'wah. Know the people whom you are addressing, that they are able to understand the message. And those who have the most right over you, that they have the ability to listen to the beautiful message of Al-Islam. We also know at the very beginning of Islam, in Mecca during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, that very few people accepted Islam, especially in the early days of Islam, in the first 3 years. So for example, we know that Abu Ubaidah Amr ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu, he embraced Islam. Abu Salama and Al-Arqam ibn Abi Arqam, and also Uthman ibn Mad'un and his two brothers, and also Sa'id ibn Zayd radiallahu anhum jami'an. These were the first people to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the first 3 years, maybe no more than 30 or 40 people. I mean, some of the scholars have different numbers on this issue, but they say for sure it was not more than 100 people. Whether it was 40 people or 50 or 60 people, this is the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the greatest of mankind, the greatest of the prophets. And in 3 years, only 50 or 60 people embraced Islam. Is that to be seen as a failure? Not at all. Because it's not about quantity, but if you look at the quality of these people who embraced Islam and what they did for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion in the future, in that from them later on, you have the four great Khulafa al-Rashideen. You have Abu Bakr and Umar, who embraced Islam about 5 years after, and then Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhum, and those other companions from them, the five who were blessed or promised the Jannah. These were, subhanallah, individuals who were so heavy on the scale in terms of how they benefited Islam. And so as individuals, we shouldn't be looking at, you know, spamming Islam to everybody and just thinking that, you know, when they embrace Islam, we forget about them when we move on to other people. What is important is that when a person embraces Islam, that they are then taught and nurtured upon Islam. So that Islam becomes the most important thing in their lives, and that they're able to take their lives forward as a Muslim. We don't realize sometimes that when a person becomes a Muslim, there's a great number of changes that they will go through. And the support that you gave to them in giving da'wah to them, they're in need of that just as much when they embrace Islam. That they will have to face their families, they will have to go through so many trials and decisions. They will inform their closest members, as of course is required upon them, if it is of course wise for them to do so. Sometimes you find brothers and sisters, they embrace Islam and they are unable to tell their families because of the reaction of their families. And in situations like this, of course, it is permitted for them to keep their Islam quiet to themselves and maybe then tell their families at a later date, bearing in mind that we don't want any harm to come to people. So this is a very important point that we take and benefit from the quiet call that the Prophet ﷺ engaged in at the very beginning of Al-Islam. Another important benefit that I want to focus on from this particular incident is that those who claim that Islam does not honor the woman, or that Islam belittles the rights of women in general, we say as Muslims, alhamdulillah, that Islam honors the woman and has raised her on the very highest of levels. In fact, in Islam, the first supporter who supported the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a woman. The first individual to embrace Islam was a woman. And this was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. That the many rights that were not given to women at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Islam came to free the woman from all these shackles of oppression. And in fact, that the woman at that time was not seen as an individual who had any rights, could be quite easily sold, could be bought, a'adhan billah. And even up into many Western countries, maybe up to 120 years or 130 years ago, they did not have the right to vote or to have an impact on their society. ولله الحمد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave these rights to a woman many, many centuries ago. And those who claim that Islam did not give anything to a woman, we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Islam gives more to the woman than any other way of life, and that these rights are protected and can be never taken away. ولله الحمد. Another benefit I want to take as well, inshallah ta'ala, and discuss is the importance of taking da'wah slowly and not to rush into da'wah, and not to think that as soon as you become a Muslim, and of course at times when you embrace Islam you are extremely happy and you want to tell the world about that, but be wise in how you teach people Islam and focus on those people who are closest to you, because they have the most right to understand and receive the message of al-Islam. And the two most important people for any individual is, if they enter into Islam, are one's parents, their mother and their father. That they are the ones who looked after and nurtured and spent all that time looking after you. These two individuals are the most important people that you should focus on in teaching Islam to. And how you deliver the message of Islam to them is of the utmost importance. No doubt they will see many changes within you, but be wise in your da'wah. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens their hearts to understand Islam. For I am sure, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, that if a person is able to see Islam in its true form, if a person is able to see Islam without any influence of media and whatever the case may be, people's biased against Islam, if Islam is presented to them just as Islam was presented by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to his people, I have no doubt if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for that individual, they will be guided to al-Islam. If it doesn't happen immediately, then bi-ithnillahi ta'ala that they will be guided in the future. There were those people from the greatest people in Islam who heard the message of Islam but did not embrace Islam immediately. If you look at the example of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he heard about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard about Islam but rejected it. Only later on that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened his heart to al-Islam. So the staunchest enemies of Islam, we make dua for them. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide them. And those people who are most beloved to ourselves, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide them as well. We ask Allah azza wa jalla to allow us to be wise, call us to Islam, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides people to Islam, to understand Islam and its true picture. Allahumma ameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.